Hello, beautiful people, and for those of you who are new to our channel, welcome. We're so blessed to have Ginger Bailey.
Hi.
She is going to be channeling not only my son, Erik, who is in the afterlife, but we have a guest on the other side, Rachel Pollack. And by the way, Paula does not want me to say everybody's link out because it's so boring. So Ginger Bailey's links and information are in the description box. She didn't like that. Well, we don't want Paula to get mad. Mama Paula. All right.
Yeah.
So Rachel Pollack, first, thank you for coming. And I'm going to give a little background about you first. Science fiction and comic book writer Rachel Pollack died April 7 at age 77. This April, I guess. She was an award-winning author, leading authority on tarot and occult, trans activist, and comic book writer who created the first mainstream transgender superhero. She came out as transgender and lesbian in 1971. Boy, she was cutting edge, and underwent transition surgery in 1978. So this is very timely, right? Because there's so much about the trans activist movement right now. So it's just perfect to have you on, Rachel. And thank you for having the courage to be who you were when you were alive, and for also, you know, honoring us with your words of wisdom in regards to this and probably other things. We have a bunch of questions from the community that I hope you can answer.
So first of all,
I love you, Erik.
Erik's gone. I love you, Mama.
So she's
saying thank you. Thank you, Elisa, for giving her a voice today and this platform to tell her story and answer questions. She's excited to be here. She's excited and she's talking about what a beautiful soul you have. She's saying talking about what a beautiful soul you have and all that you do for everybody, for the community.
Well, what about Ginger? What is she, chopped liver?
No.
Not Ginger, Rachel.
No, she's talking about me too. She's talking about the all of it. She's talking about channeling Erik, and she's just amazed at how many people this has touched.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you. All right, so questions.
Well, she's right here by Erik, and they're both sitting down, actually. Usually Eric's up walking around, but they're both sitting down. She's kind of dressed up a little bit. She's dressed up, you know, not real casual, actually. She's kind of dressed up. So and she's just ready to go. She's ready to go.
Can you describe her and how she's dressed?
So she has on she has her makeup all done up very nice, and I see her hair is kind of like wavy and short. She's short wavy hair, and she has it all nice and done up. And then she's wearing a nice blouse, like a button up blouse, and she has some really nice jewelry on, and actually she's wearing like slacks. Okay. Nice blouse and slacks.
Awesome. So you were a male that transitioned to a female. Just wanted to get that straight, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. At a very young age, she said the early 20s in the 70s.
Okay. Yeah. So when did you realize that you felt more like a female than a male in your male body? And at what age, too?
She says she cannot remember a time she ever felt like anything but a female. So since she can remember all the way back, very young, she doesn't remember like a point where she thought, I'm not, you know, I'm this, not this. And so she's saying because she always just felt like that, but she did feel uncomfortable in her skin starting out very young, like grade school. Very uncomfortable in her skin. It just wasn't right. It was like she was like this person in this skin, and it just wasn't right. She just knew it from very early on.
Wow. So was this a situation where you could have been a walk-in, a female walking into a male body, or it could be that, I mean, there's all sorts of reasons for people to be transgender. Could be, sometimes it's because they were the gender that they wanted to identify this life and another life, and they love that life so much. And, you know, so is there anything like that going on with you?
She's saying that this was a couple things. She's saying that it was a contract because of the growth and the struggle, especially in the era that she was in. Yeah. Going through this. Yeah. It is hard for everybody even now, but at that point it wasn't, you know, they would want you to hide away, hide yourself. You have that problem. It's a problem. Yeah. She's saying it was a problem. It wasn't like normal.
So being you is a problem. That's terrible.
Right. And so she's saying that, that she actually has had more incarnations as a female. Okay. So that is a little bit of it too, a little bit of it too, but mostly she's saying she came in to go through this as an experience.
Let's talk about that in relationship to this first question, actually, as the first on the list. What was your spiritual mission on Earth?
So although there's many things that she came here to do, a lot of it was to set an example, to be that example for others that struggled with the same thing that she struggled with. Yeah. And then also to entertain, and she's saying that, like, through her art, and I'm a little embarrassed, Ginger me, I'm a little embarrassed not to know, like, what her writings are or anything, okay? I'm just getting to know who she is.
But I'm sure people are going to Google you.
Yeah, I've been talking to her a little bit about it, but so she's talking about a lot of her writings were very healing to others, like the comics, the way she did the comics, and the comics actually had transgender characters in it, and so people that were dealing with this, the same thing that she's dealing with or dealt with, it really helped them to see that they weren't alone. And so she was here to heal in that kind of way and to entertain. And she also wrote, like, stories too, outside of, it looks like, outside of the comics. And then the tarot. She says she also was like an advocate for like the spiritual, like, community too. Yeah. You know, so she was connected to both, and all of that was part of her mission here, was to she was just saying to she goes, could you imagine how it was not so mainstream with the tarot cards and the fortune telling, and then I'm also transgender and lesbian, and she's going down the line, and she goes, but you put all that together in a package, and she goes, and you can really influence those, you know, that need influence, and help those that, you know, feel the same way and are kind of lost. It gives them a little bit of peace, she said.
You can be transgender and a superhero. So there we go. When was it the first time you heard about tarot and you became interested in tarot and other things like that?
So she's saying this was like early in the 70s, and she, the 70s? Yeah, 70s, she's saying. And she said tarot found her, actually. And it was just something that she was heard about, like she heard about, and she started looking into and was drawn to it. I was drawn to it.
Okay.
And so it kind of pulled her. She's making it like, you know, it pulled her to it.
And
instead of her seeking it out, she felt pulled to it. And so it was, yeah, it was the early 70s, mid 70s is what did it. And then she said that she just everything just started opening up for her after that, like her mind and writings and stuff just started flowing.
Wow. Was your opening to magic or spiritualism happening at the same time you decided to come out as transgender and lesbian? I think we answered that, right? It sort of happened at the same time in the early 70s?
Yeah. Yeah. She's saying it happened at the same time, around the same time.
But was there a relation between the two? How are these two big shifts in your life, opening to magic and transitioning, related to each other, if at all, if it is?
No, she's saying that it's not, it's not that they're related in a way, like one made the other one easier. She's saying that it just happened to be around the same time. And she's saying that she got to a point where she felt confident enough in, you know, society or like her circle of people. And she just was done feeling uncomfortable, was done with it. It was like, it was just time. She's saying she kind of wish she could have done it. She would have done it a little bit earlier, you know, just when she was here, she kind of thought about that, but she says, everything has its time. Everything has its moment. And, and so then it unfolded that way, but it wasn't one influencing the other, she said.
But is there a connection between the two, not just timing wise, but a connection between you're being transgendered and your interest in spiritualism? I'm going to look up your hero.
No, she's saying that not really. And except for the fact that she just learned a lot about herself, a lot more about herself, you know, and a little bit more. She did a lot of research beyond the tarot. She did a lot of research reading all different things like mythology, she's showing me like she has a degree, obviously she's a writer, in English. And so she was just very interested in all the aspects of spiritualism, mythology, aliens, space, you know, all of it. She was interested in all of it. And so it really, she's not saying like there was like really a connection or a influence, or that's what you're asking, right? Like that maybe had something to do with it, except for the fact that she started getting to know who she was better. Ooh. You know,
well, did tarot help you learn?
Yes, it did.
What was your most significant source of education or inspiration when learning tarot? Maybe it was channel, who knows?
Yeah, she never put it that way, that things were channeled to her, but she kind of always knew, you know, that's, you know, what you're getting. You look at it as your intuition. It's a natural thing. Yeah. So that's how she kind of looked at it. So she's not pointing out any big thing, except for when she wrote her first book, and then it became like she got an award for it, I guess. Ooh. For tarot, for that first book she wrote about tarot. And she said that really inspired her to continue and look more into it, because there was something there. She just kept going. I just felt it. There was something there. There's just something there. And she's being pulled to do it.
So now that you cross over, can you share any new insights about how the tarot really works? Do our higher self, spirit, guides, angels, and ancestors communicate with us through the cards? Or is it more the wisdom of the collective unconsciousness, or perhaps both or neither?
So what she's saying is that with the cards, you can look at a card, she says, and it can mean something depending on what you're doing at the time, maybe whatever a question is or somebody that you're reading for. She goes, it can have a certain meaning. Then you can look at it again and with some other situation, and then it has a different meaning. Okay. Mm-hmm. So the cards actually have a meaning depending on what the intention is, what the message is, she's saying. And she's saying that with this, you get a mix of things, she says. You have to bring in your knowledge of all things, you know. Your intuition is a part of it. She says, yes, it's channeled, even though she didn't really look at it like that then. But looking from a spiritual point of view, yes, definitely channeled by your guides, and which is our, you know, your internal intuition. And she's saying that that she's given advice. The best advice for tarot reading is to know that it's not so much the cards, but it's what the cards get you to feel and see and hear to translate to your client. Yeah. To whoever you're reading for. Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
What are the signs that one should look for that indicate a false tarot reading? Good questions.
Yeah, good question. She says that, so if you're okay, so she's saying that if you're focusing too much on the meaning, like you go and you do a set, like you lay out a set, right, of cards. And she goes, and then you're focusing too much on what you read about the card and what it means.
Oh,
and you're
no.
to go back to that. She goes, that's kind of a sign that it's not really, you know, giving you that much. But if you're following what you feel as you lay them out or what you're getting from it, like intuitively, then you know that that's, you know, what it's trying to tell, what it's trying to say. And most of the time, with or without cards, she's saying, you're going to get the right coming through, the right answer coming through if you're listening, you know, intuitively inside and not trying to go word for word or, you know, be so like looking at the books. The books, I guess, have like explanations. If you're not looking at it so literally, thank you. I couldn't think of the word.
Okay.
She's looking at it so literally so much as in getting what it makes you feel, what you think. You
like
know, it's kind of a
rocket.
guide.
Just
Yeah.
Like
And it's
out.
A guide. She
yeah.
says it's like any tool that you would use as a psychic medium. Okay. This is the same. You use it for a guide. It's a guidance system, because they are going to say something different each time. So that's why you don't want to read exactly in the book of what the meaning of it is. Yeah, it kind of gives you an idea if you read it over, but don't use that to do your readings, she said. Yeah.
Have you ever had your course is a tool of divination, and if you don't protect yourself, you can have all sorts of things from the dark coming in. Have you ever had problems with that, or did you always protect yourself?
So she said her focus was never on something like that. So she really never dealt with something like that. And she did go in with like, it's interesting because she's making it like, she says, like, she didn't look at herself so much like, you know, psychic medium or connecting to a spirit. It was more about the cards and her own intuition.
Okay.
So, but she's
circuit.
Saying, yeah, kind of like that. But she's saying that, she didn't experience stuff like that and she didn't worry about it. She's saying, yeah.
What is the most accurate and true deck to the original, which Ross said in The Law of One? And maybe this goes with this. What would you say is the easiest and fastest way to learn how to read tarot cards, or maybe the best deck for beginners? So you can maybe talk about good starting points. Which deck you think is the most accurate? Just about tarot decks.
Yeah, she's saying that there isn't just one accurate tarot deck. She's saying that she says that not only are there like tarot decks that are created, you know, in the store and people, you know, create these to sell them like you would write a book, you
right,
know,
right.
But she says that it's what those cards say to you, not so much what deck it is, you know, because again, it's just a tool guiding you that's using you to open you up. It opens you up to think more, to look further, to look deeper, to use your, you know, spiritual imagination to let it flow through. So she's saying there's no particular deck, but she does say that a lot more people are creating their own decks now. Like they did that a little bit back then, but nowadays there's more people creating their own with their own art. She says those actually have more of a personal connection. So if she had to pick what was better, she would say one that is personally close to you. Mm-hmm. So yeah, she's saying it's not one out there that you need to go get that's the best one. It's
so pretty much you are the deck. That's what you're
right.
saying.
You
right. are the deck.
Absolutely.
The deck is not okay.
Right.
Hmm.
Right.
What was it like being transgender in the 70s? Holy God. I'm going to look up a picture of your superhero. So sometimes I'm looking at the phone. Sorry, but go ahead.
It was a challenge. She's going to give that word. She said, I'll give that word challenge. It was a challenge. Of course, she's saying that she wasn't going to let society or anyone else decide what was best for her. She always knew she would do what's best for her, yeah. You know, in a mental health sense and a physical sense, emotional sense, all of it. She would stand by who she is no matter what, and not let society dictate to what she should be. Hold on. She's giving me this. It's better. She said, it's better to be hated for who you are than to love for who you are not, is what she just said.
Oh, wow.
And I just got chills. I just got chills. So she's
oh,
like,
wow. That was profound.
Yeah, she's saying that was her. She would like really repeat that to herself a lot too. And she wants people to know out there that are dealing with the same thing, and there are very many,
mm-hmm.
That it is important to stay true to who you are. And those aren't just words. Listen to what that says, she said. True to who you are inside and out is more important, no matter what, because people are going to say what they're going to say no matter what. They're going to think what they're going to think no matter what, she said.
You can't be responsible for their opinions and thoughts.
Yeah, and they're not in charge of your happiness, she said. Yeah. So just know.
You're in charge of how you react to them.
Right, exactly. And they're not, she goes, and a person that is not accepting of you shouldn't have value on how, you know, you look, think, feel anyway. They shouldn't have any value. You shouldn't give any value to their thoughts about you. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's what she's saying.
Okay. So look, this is kind of cool. That's, well, it might be hard to see, but yeah.
Yeah.
It kind of works. But
so, yeah. So
I suspect they like my powers, but couldn't handle me. This is from the new Earth. Which is DC comic. Interesting.
Yeah, she said that this character, this was Doom Patrol, I think. She just said.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But it is DC. Yes.
Okay.
It's DC. But it's like the group, I guess. And she said that this character, of course, was when you're writing and you're making characters in fiction, that you always use a little bit of who you are. You know, a little bit of you goes into it, of who you are. And so she really had fun. She's saying, I had so much fun writing in the comic. She did others too, but I don't know what these are. There are other comics that she wrote.
Okay, well, this is the question along these lines. You created DC Comics' first trans superhero, Kate Coagula Godwin, the first superhero to save the world with the powers of being transsexual. What is your spiritual perspective on being trans? What do you mean by what's the power? What powers did you use? What transsexual powers did you use?
Well, I mean, it's a powerful thing to say that you are of the minority or the, you know, weaker part of, you know, society. Not that she said that about herself, but
right.
What others, and then come out and be a hero and fight crime and, you know, and fight against monsters or whatever it is in the comic. But she's showing me something about the powers. This is actually, I don't know if this is what they're wanting to know, but she's showing me the powers of this person, and maybe you can look and check. Add something to do with molecular changing, like melting of things or something. But she's saying that the actual internal power comes from being able to, you know, go along with who you are and be who you are and still overcome.
Be you.
Yeah.
Own it.
Right. And overcome everything that she does in this comic.
What is your spiritual perspective on being transsexual? What does coming into the human body and wanting to change sex represent to you?
So it's not just for her. It was also for others to, whenever somebody goes through a struggle in their life, others also grow from it too. They okay. See it. They grow from it. They identify. It's a way to identify too for themselves. But for her herself, she's saying this was something that she came in to do because the growth that she's seen from this, as in, I can crawl up in a little ball. This is her words. I can crawl up in a little ball and hide in a corner, or I can stand up on my own two feet and be the woman I know I am. It's how she's saying it. Yeah. So, there is a big lesson and growth in that. She's showing, like, you can be down here or you can be up here with it. And there's big growth in between that, you know?
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
Okay. What percentage do society created ideas about gender identities and taught expectations of gender roles make up a person's feelings that they are in the wrong body? Okay, let me read that.
Yeah.
How much is it so society created ideas about gender ideas? And how compared to that and taught expectations of gender roles make up a person's feelings that they're in the wrong body? In other words,
so like is it
coming externally, the external ideas about gender identities and expectations about gender roles, how much of it is, what percent is that instead of coming from within?
Okay, so instead of like following like maybe a fad compared to,
I don't know
of it
maybe.
In a way, yeah, because that's what it kind of feels like. So, and like what a society thinks about it. So she's saying that the bigger percent is what you feel inside, what you feel inside. And there is a lot of influence on the outside, and there are some, there's a very few, small percent, she's going to say 1% maybe, that will be influenced and think, oh, well, maybe that's me because I'm dealing with this, that maybe that's me, maybe I'm transgender, maybe I'm lesbian, or
it reports in the, I mean, in the news of people who had reassignment surgery and then all of a sudden.
Right. There, it's a small amount, and it does happen. It does happen. Absolutely. But again, she's saying that that is, and Eric's like, yeah, going like that, that no matter what, there's an experience and a growth and a lesson in everything. Even if you did it and then you didn't want to do it, that's still something that you're
a spiritual
learning.
Contract too. In
right.
Many cases.
Yeah. Right.
How many trans people are just not used to having that gendered body because they've had a lot of successful, we alluded to this, lifetimes as the other gender.
What are they asking? What? How much?
How many, I guess percentage, whatever, trans people. Okay. I mean, it's very common for trans people are just not used to having that gendered body that they're born into because they've had a lot of successful lifetimes as the other gender that they eventually want to transition into.
She's going to say she's saying like a bigger percent is that. Some of it is just coming in. I mean, they're both contracts. I mean, even if you come in, you know, both of them, both ways, it's a contractual thing. It's an experience you came to go through, but she's saying a bigger amount of them are because they've spent more lifetimes as the other gender.
Okay. Interesting. Absolutely. That's what I feel. Yeah. I mean, in many cases. Are these perhaps spiritual lessons to see how the other half lives? Is that sometimes the case? Be quiet, Bella.
No, this is more of an internal growth, and more of an internal like they're not like, oh, I wonder what it would be like.
Yeah, okay.
This is that's her not, doing this. She goes, she goes, I wonder what it'll be like to be a woman because that looks fun. She goes, no, you're uncomfortable in your skin. You want to rip it off. And that's pretty profound, she says. So yeah, it's not about wanting to see what it's like with the other side. She's saying no to that.
Yeah. What's the best way to counter this wave of anti-trans legislation that we're facing? Get out of your armchairs and pick it.
Yeah.
It's far.
Yeah. To use your voice to keep making a stand, to non be perseverance. Yeah. Keep at it. Don't give up. Yeah. Because if you look at how far they've came, you know, with it, with this fight, it is getting somewhere.
Well,
so
I think so.
That's what
for
she's
sure.
saying, that it is getting somewhere. Yeah. So don't give up, she says. Don't give up. And stay, you know, strong to the fact that no matter how hard it gets, you are doing the right thing.
Yeah.
Because sometimes people think, oh, this is, you know, maybe it's not the right thing, you know, but no, she's saying it is. Yeah. It is.
What are your thoughts about parents letting their kids transition at a very early age nowadays?
This is a touchy one.
As a doctor, I disagree with that because there's so much confusion, especially around puberty, etc. And you got these social cues that just wait until the judgment in the brain, the ability to judge, gels in that person.
Right. Right. And but you know what?
Because you have to have puberty blockers before, you know, I don't, it's tough.
She's actually agreeing with you she's agreeing with some of that, but she's also saying that she feels that one of the most important things is counseling, to know that it's really coming from a place of an internal, you know, feeling and not external. Mm-hmm. So that's mostly important. So she's not saying one way or another, like, okay, you shouldn't do that to your kids. She's saying that you need to step up and at least take note that they're crying out about something, yeah, and you need to get counseling for them. They need to help them know for sure too. You know what I mean? And then she says there's another side of it. Then there's parents that push this for a society reason
child.
Right, right. She says, so that's why it's really important that the child make this decision, even though they're kind of immature too, but it doesn't mean you have to rush it. She was in her 20s, she said.
Yeah.
Make her own decision. She said, you don't have to rush it as a child. Just go through the steps, follow the steps, and take it in that direction instead of jumping in, because this is something that's a lifetime. She says, this, you don't just get this surgery and then all of a sudden you're on with your life. She goes, this is a lifetime of change that you go through, she said.
But I had a family member who, when she began to go into puberty, she did not like having boobs. Oh, I don't want to be a girl. She, she thought about that, but then that shame of becoming the ultimate female, or adult male or female, can sometimes influence the decision, I suppose.
Right. Well, she's saying too that that's why it's important to do the counseling and to stay on track with it. You don't have to make all the huge changes in the beginning. You take that process, you know, go through this the process slowly, because there are a lot of not just kids but adults that feel a certain way because of society, even though they're confused. It's not because they're choosing, oh, they think this is cool, so I'm doing it, but they're kind of confused with their own identity in a way. It's an identity thing, and sometimes they mix that up, she's saying, like they'll mix those kind of things up with, you know, oh, maybe I'm that, you know. But that's why the counseling is important, to really find out what's going on and where this is coming from. So
but then I've seen in some cases counselors, and including through the hospitals that do the reassignment surgery, push it. And I'm wondering if some of these hospitals just want the money, you know, of the
gym. Right. Yeah. Right. Well, that's why. No, she's saying that there's a little bit of that sometimes, but for the most part, you just want to make sure that there's no affiliation between counseling and doctors. Really. Yeah.
Exactly.
You don't want that connection in there, you know. So, but a lot of it, they're getting better. She just said they're getting better with getting more transgender counselors out there.
Good.
Counselors that are, you know, their focus is going in that direction. So it's not just a regular, you know, every day I'm having a bad day type, you know, counseling. It's, you know, directed towards that. Right. And they didn't have that. She said, I didn't have that when I was younger. So, you know, it's nice that they're finally doing that, she said.
That's good. And, you know, when they ultimately make the decision, parents and siblings, et cetera, need to be loving and supportive. You know, like,
absolutely.
Right. And when your little 4-year-old boy starts to play with dolls, it's okay.
You know, she's saying to encourage any kind. She doesn't like stereotype.
Right.
Okay, she don't like stereotyping. That everybody's a human being. Everybody can love. Everybody can have emotions. And she wasn't raised in that era of thinking that way, but, you know, she learned it over time, and it's the way she feels. And she's saying that from a spiritual point of view too, that with children, you have to let them explore. How are they going to know who they are? You can't tell them who they are. You know, you can't get mad at them for who you think they might be because it's their journey, not yours.
Yes.
You're just here to watch over them. This is their individual journey.
And don't be a crybaby. You're crying like a girl.
Right,
like
right.
That. You know.
Well, yeah, and you need to encourage any kind of, you know, showing emotion, encourage them to find out who they are and don't be judgmental and, you know, be supportive. Even if you don't agree with it, try to be supportive and understand it. That's where the problem is. If you don't try to understand, some parents don't even want to try to understand. And I'm not pinpointing anybody out there. I'm just saying that there is those that, you know, don't try even to understand because they have their own idea of what they see their children to grow up and be. And yeah, and the fear, absolutely. You know, fear of people talking about them or what they will think. And then there's the opposite that want people to talk about them and want people to go, oh, look, you have, you know, a transgender child. So, you know, they push it on the child. If they show one little, like they think they show some like little sign. So anyway, she says it's important to find that balance and just be supportive of your children. Let them find themselves.
What do you think about schools that are trying to like prohibit letting the parent know what's going on? And there have been cases where teachers have actually taken a child to drag shows or whatever. I don't know. I can't remember exactly. Without the consent of the parent and trying to push them into transgenderism. And the school board says, you can't tell the parents that. What do you think about that?
No.
The parents are
She doesn't agree with that. She doesn't agree with that. And she says this. She says it's not just for that either. Anything that you don't have, you know, that's in your family, because every family has their rules and morals and things that they raise their child with. Nobody has the right to come in and mess with that.
Yeah.
You know, they don't have the right for that. So with anything, you know, you should always check with the parent first, always, because you don't know, the parent might, you know, be, and even if the parent isn't somebody who might be supportive of something, it's still not up to you.
Still
to
the parent.
That. It's still the parent.
And that's
right?
The parent and child's journey, spiritual journey in that lifetime.
Right. And you can offer, she says, you can offer. It's fine to offer or suggest, you know, maybe a few different, like, oh, well, maybe, you know, I have this that you can look into to help parents understand that maybe are kind of more closed-minded. You can offer that stuff, but always include the parent, she said. It's important because that's going to mess the relationship up between the child and the parent.
That's true. I didn't think about that. How was your crossing over, Rachel?
She said that she was very, very sad to be leaving her wife and very sad, you know, sad, you know, to, she had still things that she wanted to do, but she's saying she was very happy to be out of the sick body. Having cancer, she said, was awful. Okay. But she said once she transitioned, of course, it was peaceful and a relief.
Was
a
there
big
a
relief.
Spiritual reason for you having cancer? Trapped emotions, conflict,
Yeah, she said that yes. She actually said yes. She said yes, a little bit of that was the just the struggles and trapped emotions, conflict, things that she dealt with going through what she went through, which you can, you know, go through that with other life problems, but with what she dealt with, that yes, it was part of it. Yeah. Another part was just what she contracted on the way she was going to exit. But absolutely, she said.
Was your crossing over kind of what you expected or different? Any surprises? Besides,
she said it was more natural than she expected. Actually, she said it was, you don't know, you just don't know for sure, she says. But before she passed, she said that she did feel the spiritual, like it's almost like a spiritual veil kind of lifting before she even left her body, and so she would feel like a peace around her in a way. So it's almost, she says that it was comforting in a way because it makes it to where it's nothing to fear. And it's natural. It just felt natural, she said, like something natural you're supposed to do.
Have you reincarnated yet?
No, no.
If you do, what's your plans for the next lifetime? Do you want to be a woman, a man, a transgender? or what? I mean, does not just along the gender lines, but what are your plans?
She said, yeah, she will probably, she's saying that she doesn't have them all made out yet, but she will be coming back as a female in the next life.
Okay.
And then she said, hopefully sometime down the line in the future, and she knows other people wish this too, there won't be so much identity and you know, labels.
Right.
You know, and you just come in and you are who you are, is what she, you know, says. So
I always tell my kids, when they're fighting with people or whatever, I said, just let people be who they are, man. And I also told them, be you and own it. That came from my eldest daughter. She taught me that. I'm sure somebody else said it first. All right. What's your most recent past life that influenced your life as Rachel?
She shows me this life, and it looks like it's about the end of the 1700s, maybe a little, maybe mid 1700s. And she was a female in that life. And she shows me that she was like, she's funny, like a barmaid type. Like she was like in a, she actually owned like a saloon.
Wow.
Like a saloon showing me. And
unusual back then.
Right, right. And so she goes, I kind of lived a man's life in a female body. That's what she said.
Interesting. Like that girl.
She was a great cowboy. She goes, I was a great cowboy.
Oh my God, that's cool. All right, you lived a life here on Earth. How are you creating purpose on the other side? I just love my peeps. They have the best questions.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah.
They're all good. She said that she absolutely like she just loves this. She's talking about how much she loves doing this. She loves guiding new writers, you know, authors and writers in their writings. And she brings support to people that are struggling, not just the LGBT you know, community or any of that, but people that are struggling. She likes to bring supportive like energy, you know, to them. She's also doing a lot of like research and learning and stuff on the other side, because she's really loves like the alien stuff and space and, you know, things that have to do with like mysteries and things like that. She just loves it. So a lot of learning too she's doing on the other side, taking in info.
Did I talk about Paola's experience when we were recording or before we recorded?
Before, I think. Before.
Yeah, so Paola, you know, Paola, she's in charge of the YouTube channel and she's doing the documentary and stuff. She, the other day, yesterday, saw a freaking UFO hovering over her like a cube / sphere, just hovering there. And
right.
You know, I'm sure she'll tell about her experience. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, it's cool, I think, that it's finally coming out, you know, more and more.
It's real, about people.
This. Yeah.
Coming to a city near you. All right, here, this is interesting. You died April 7th at the age of 77. You had transition surgery in the 70s. Does the number 7 have a particular meaning for you? And we just have a couple more questions.
You know, she says that it was her favorite number. She said that was my favorite number. So it had some kind of significance in some way. But from a spiritual point of view, she says it was just because, you know, it's, I don't really understand all this, but she's talking about like the astral, you know, like numerology and stuff. It did have somewhere it fit in there with her life in numerology.
You probably have a whole hour on you describing
right
meaning for you.
It's like over my head. Boom.
Yeah, numerology is cool. All right. First of all, is there any little known fact about you that's kind of fun, even that nobody knows or very few people know?
She had a sister. She's saying that she was very particular about her lipsticks.
Oh, okay.
That's what she just said. Very particular about her lipsticks. Like she had them like set up a certain way and certain colors, and she wouldn't use certain ones. So she was very particular about that. That's one. That's a good one. I like that one.
So what, how long have you known Erik, and what do you think about him? Did y'all just meet prior to this, or?
Actually, no, she said, being that like time and space and all that's different on the other side, you know, she said that she knew him pretty close. I mean, it's hard to say, like, you know, a time, there's no time, but pretty close to, pretty close to not long after she passed, because she knew that this was coming. And so she... She's putting her arm around him. She goes, I just love him. He's just so funny. He's great. And she's just like talking about how he's like a trickster on that side too.
Oh my God. There's no peace for anybody on either side of the
Nope.
Gotta love him. Funny. Any final thoughts or messages to the people listening to this interview, Rachel, before we close? My light went out. That's okay.
I didn't even notice. So she just wants people to know that she just wants people to know to follow what your gut tells you to do. Yeah. You know, listen to your internal voice, because it knows you better than you know yourself, she said. Mm-hmm. So listen to it. And if you struggle listening or knowing, just, you know, find a way to find that, you know, internal voice and listen to it, because it's going to get you through. It's going to get you through. And she says, don't let things dictate what you do with your life.
External things, for sure.
Yeah, right. Don't let things, external things.
Maybe automatic writing, your feelings would flow, bypass the brain and go to the paper, if that would help you figure out who and what you are.
Oh, absolutely. It's, you know, like journaling. That's why you journal, she says, you know. And a lot of journaling is finding out who you are inside and keeping a diary of it, because you learn a lot. You learn a lot from yourself.
That's true.
She said, so pay attention.
All right. Thank you, Rachel Pollack. And thank you, Ginger Baby.
She said, thank you.
And thank you, Erik. I love all of you guys. And y'all check
love you.
Link out for Ginger. Okay. She's awesome. We've got a lot going on. More than just channeling. We talked
about
the radio show, actually.
Oh, yeah. 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 And I also have that, you know, the life coach that I started, I actually started also doing a discount for that, to where if you want to do more than one, you get a discount if you're doing more than one. So that's on my website too.
Package deal. Yeah. Check it out. Really, really comb through her website. It's pretty awesome. And also, you gotta be sure you, you know, subscribe to this channel, the Atlantis Scalar channel. Hit the notification bell, subscribe. Shane,
like,
Paula always makes me do this, and I sometimes all right,
hit the like button.
oh, that too. Okay, all right, I love y'all. Bye,
love you. Bye.